falls on Granada and the Andalusia region in Spain, it's been another busy day of action at the 27th Winter Universiade. In this recap, we'll head to the snow-covered mountains of Sierra Nevada for the women's giant slalom. Short track has its first day of competition, so we'll visit the igloo for the 1500 meters. In hockey action, it's playoff time, and first we'll see defending champion Canada versus Japan in women's semifinal play, while in men's quarterfinal action, Russia takes on Slovakia. You see there the beautiful blue skies here in the Sierra Nevada mountains just outside of Granada as we get ready for the women's giant slalom. Very nice day up here in the mountains, -6 degrees Celsius. We have 75 competitors from 25 countries competing here this afternoon. And there you see again the temperature, snow temperature -8 degrees, so the conditions have been quite good here over the last few days up in the Sierra Nevada mountains. We'll start off with Sabina Majerczyk of Poland. This is her first run. Each athlete will do two runs. It'll be the combined total time of both that will determine the final rankings. Pretty solid run here so far for the Pole Majerczyk. And she will set the standard at 1:06.43. Next we'll move to Lisa Pfeiffer of Italy. She was 9th earlier in the week in the Super G here at Universiade and 26th in the Super combined. And at the interval, just under 1 second behind Majerczyk's time. Losing a little bit of speed there at the lower part of the course, but she actually gained some time and she'll move into first place, 0.11 of a second ahead of Majerczyk. Now it's Jana Gontnerova of Slovakia. She competed at the Sochi Olympics, but unfortunately did not finish her slalom or super combined races. You see her at the end trying to beat Pfeiffer's time, and she will do it. 0.06 of a second ahead, and she now moves into first spot. Now we go to Christina Falsa Osberg of Norway. She has really enjoyed her time here in the mountains. Won gold in the Universiade Super G back on February 6th. And at the interval, she again is ahead 0.4 of a second there on Gontnerova. And will she build on that lead? Yes. 2.08 seconds in front. A great race there for Norway's Osberg, who is just loving her time in the Sierra Nevada mountains. Now Andorra's Carmina Palace. She was 6th in the Granada Super G here at Universiade and 12th in the Super combined. Almost a second back at the interval. So she will have quite a bit of time to try to make up here in the lower part of the course to knock off Osberg's great race. And it looks like she won't quite do it. And she will move into 8th place here in the opening run. And there you have the standings after that first run. And now we'll get ready for the second. Here is Carmina Palace again of Andorra. She did finish 8th in that first run. Was 3rd in an FIS giant slalom race at Pala de Casa, also here in Spain, back in January. And she works her way down towards the bottom of the course. Conditions holding up here as the race continues on. And Lucy Picard right now setting the pace here in this second race, and it is Palace who will move into first place, at least temporarily. And now Sabina Majerczyk. She was 4th after the first run. Has had some top finishes in slalom and giant slalom at the Australian New Zealand Cup last August. And at the interval, a little bit ahead of Palace's time. And picking up good speed here in the lower part of the course. carving quite well around those gates. And Meyerchik will come in ahead of Palace, and she now moves into first spot. Now here's Lisa Pfeiffer of Italy. Third after the first run. Was 10th in the Giant Slalom at Trentino in her home hosted Universiade back in 2013. Again, picking up good speed here on the lower part of the course. There's Meyerchik's time to beat, and Pfeiffer won't do it. She will slide into fourth spot. Now Gontnerova of Slovakia. Second after that opening run, she's gonna have to put down a really good time to be in contention to knock off Osberg's time. And there is Gontnerova making her way down through those final gates. And she's almost a second back of Meyerchik. Her second run was 12th. And now it is Osberg of Norway who put up that outstanding time in her first run. 1 minute 4.18 seconds, almost 2 seconds ahead of Gontnerova's time, which was second. And there you see Meyerchik's time, and Osberg again just destroying this course. And assuming she can just stay on her feet, she will end up with her second gold medal here at Universiade in Granada. And as she makes her way carefully down through those final gates, and she is going to do it. What an outstanding run there by Osberg. She will finish second in both the first and second runs and post a total time of 2 minutes 9.56 seconds, and you see the smile on her face. Her second gold medal of these games, Sabina Meyerchik of Poland, she will claim the silver medal, and the bronze will go to Carmina Palace of Andorra. And there you see Osberg with the spoils here at the flower ceremony. So a great day here in the women's giant slalom in the Sierra Nevada mountains at Universiade in Granada. From the Universiade Igloo, short track speed skating competition gets underway here at Universiade in Granada. First up, it'll be the women's 1500 meters. Short track was first introduced at Universiade back in 1985 and has been part of the permanent program since 1989. In 2011 in Harbin, the Korean team won 6 women's medals, while China won 3. And so they are well represented here again today. And there you see the 6, Along Kim of Korea wearing helmet 19, Yunbyul Lee of Korea wearing helmet number 20, Han Yu Tong of China, she's in helmet 6, Carrie Morrison of Canada is sporting helmet number 4, Hong Shuang Lee of China has helmet number 8, and then Hak Yung Sun of Korea, helmet 22. Pretty slow to start, typical of this race as they ease into things. Of course, it's 1,500 meters, so a fair ways to go. And in the early going, it is Sun of Korea with the lead. And now the Canadian Carrie Morrison takes over. No one looking to push the pace quite yet until just there. Morrison picks it up a little bit as she's challenged again by Sun. In Trentino in 2013, Korea took 3 medals, while China took 4. And if we look back on the Sochi Olympics a year ago in Russia, China and Korea combined for 8 of the 12 women's medals that were handed out. So again, quite dominant in this sport are the Koreans and the Chinese. In front there, that is number 19, Along Kim. She was a gold medal winner at Sochi with her teammates in the 3,000-meter relay. So it is Kim right now, followed up by Lee of Korea. And the Canadian Morrison hanging tight. She was 11th at Universiade in Trentino in the 1,500 meters. She trains out of the Olympic Oval in Calgary. So it's Lee and Kim now having built up a bit of a lead as we come right near the finish. Morrison trying to hang on to that third spot. And just at the line, she's beaten out. So the two Koreans claim gold and silver, along Kim with gold, and Yoonbil Lee with silver. And then just at the line, it is Han Yutong of China just stretching that right skate out, and she'll claim the bronze medal. And there you see the gold medalist, Along Kim, in a time of 2 minutes, 33.829 seconds. Yoonbil Lee of Korea, second, 2 minutes, 34.168 seconds. She was second in the 1,500 meters at the Vancouver Olympics. And then Han of China with bronze in 2:34.339. We now move to the men's competition. In this competition, three Korean skaters. One from China, one from Canada, and one from the U.S. Helmet number 77 being worn by Seyeong Park of Korea. Number 74 is Seungsoo Han, also of Korea. From China in helmet 55 is Guang Chen. From Canada, number 52 is Pascal Dion. The third Korean, helmet number 78, that's Yira Seo. And then from the United States in helmet 99, it is Adam Callister. Moving in front there, that is Han of Korea. He did compete at the 2014 World Short Track Championships in Montreal. Now it is the American Callister moving in front. He was a part of a bronze medal win by the U.S. in the 3,000-meter relay at the 2012 World Junior Short Track Championships. Now the pace starts to pick up. All three Koreans now in front. As they just work together here. Here you see number 55, that's Chen of China, trying to break up that Korean pack. All six pretty tightly bunched here. Callister, the American, has now fallen back into sixth spot. Dion, the Canadian, is fourth. Now he moves up into third spot. So the two Koreans out in front, that's Park and Han, as they start to build a big lead. And at the line, you see the little spinorama as Han almost loses his balance, but hangs on just enough to take silver. Park from Korea, the gold. And it'll be Guang Chen of China. In 2 minutes, 33 seconds, 0.509, he will take the bronze. And he'll see a good close-up of that spin. Just catches his blade there, but a great job by Han to not lose his balance as the Canadian and Chinese skaters were coming up right behind. And now the medal ceremony. There is Park of Korea. He was at the Sochi Olympics along with his two sisters. Han again, the silver medal. And there you see Chen of China, the bronze. So a great opening day of short track competition here in Granada, and the mascot getting into it as well, claiming his spot at the top of the podium. As they get the ice ready, it's time for women's playoff hockey action from the Mulhacén Pavillion here in Granada. It's Japan versus Canada. Canada, the three-time defending champions. They finished the round robin 1-1 after suffering their first ever Universiade loss 3-1 to Russia. Japan was 3-0 after round-robin play with wins over China, the United States, and Spain. These two teams actually met each other in the semifinal at the Universiade in Trentino, with Canada all over Japan in that one, 15-0. Japan, though, does bring a veteran team here to Granada. Eight members of this team played in the Sochi Olympics 1 year ago. Starting goaltenders for Japan, it'll be Nana Fujimoto, plays at Vortex Sapporo. She was at the Olympics. And for Canada, it's Nicole Kasteris of the University of Toronto. Canada's first opportunity comes right here as it's 4 acres with the chance stopped by the right pad of Fujimoto. Now Canada again. This is Alexa Normore. That one, though, controlled fairly easily by Fujimoto, and then Japan back the other way. And this is Fujimoto there with a weak wrister controlled pretty easily by Kasteris. We'll get a quick replay of it. No problem on that rebound. Canada here with the neutral zone turnover. And Osawa will have the chance upcoming right here for Japan. Initially blocked, and there is Osawa. But that one fired over top of the crossbar. So no scoring after the opening period between Japan and Canada. Now moving to the second. Good speed through the neutral zone. That is Maggie Litchfield-Med with a shot on goal. She follows up the rebound but does end up on the ice. But midway through the period, puck will squirt back right there, and that is Julia Clinton with the great shot. The initial chance for Tess Houston, she almost put it in, but Clinton blasts that one past Fujimoto, and Canada is up 1-0. Later in the period, puck gets centered right here, and a great little tip in. That's Morgan McAfee. She bangs home the Lanceleff centering pass. It's her second of the tournament. Canada now up 2-0. There's a block shot, though, for Japan, and it's Moritake in alone. But she fires that one high and just off the crossbar as it beats Kasteris, but not the bar. With about 6 minutes to go in the second period, Japan does get on the board. It is Shiori Koike with the initial shot tipped by Mayu Iwasaki. And Japan now only trails by one. Moments later with Japan on the power play, defenseman pinches and a great pass there by Laura Brooker springs Tess Houston. She's in alone and fires it home to put Canada up 3-1. A big shorthanded goal for the Canadians. Japan, though, on that same power play, will get one back. Great little pass there. That is Haruma Yonayama to Chiho Osawa. And Japan only now by a goal. Yonayama was at the Olympics as well, as you see her great pass from behind the net. Three, two now heading into the third period of play. Cross ice pass there, and it's Litchfield Med. She'll fire that one right into the glove of Fujimoto. Later in the third period, great little pass there, and it is Litchfield Med. She'll put the puck right in the middle, and following up to bang home the rebound, that is again Morgan McAfee with her third of the tournament, second of the game, to put Canada back up by two, 4-2. Now just over a minute left in the hockey game. Canada on the cycle. It'll be Daly Audie who picks it up. She thinks she scores there. It goes off the blocker of Fujimoto, but Alexa Normore bangs the rebound home. Got a good look at it there. And that puts Canada up 5-2. And that should ice it for the Canadians. And here are the final seconds. Canada breathes a sigh of relief. Japan puts on a great show here, but Canada victorious 5-2. They outshoot Japan 39-22 and are led by Morgan McAfee's two goals and helped by that key shorthanded goal by University of Alberta Panda product Tess Houston. In the other semifinal, Russia was all over China 10-0, so Canada will take on Russia now in the gold medal final tomorrow, Thursday, February 12th at 8:30 p.m. Granada time. It is playoff time in men's ice hockey here at Universiade in Granada. Quarterfinal action. This one features Russia and Slovakia. Russia comes into this quarterfinal with a 2-1 record, having defeated Sweden, Korea, but with a loss to Canada. Slovakia, they lost to the Czech Republic, but then defeated China and Spain. There you see the Slovakian fans all set to go for this one. Starting goaltender for Russia, it'll be Sergei Belov. And for Slovakia, it'll be Juraj Halo. There you get a look at Slovakian coach Andrej Vigo. And there is the opening faceoff. And a couple minutes in, here's Michael Klimchuk. He rips one off the mask of Halo and out of play. Russia again with some pressure. Petrakov comes right in front with the backhand, and it's swept home there by Edward Gimatov. You see there the initial shot can't be controlled by Halo, and Gimatov will score his third of the tournament. He played a couple years back at the World Junior Hockey Championships for Russia. Now here is Lebedev allowed to walk right into the slot, and he wrists one into the glove of Halo. Russia keeps up the pressure. Oleg Lee on a partial breakaway. Can't quite control the puck, but a nice pad save there by the Slovakian goaltender. Now with under 5 minutes to go. Great move to the inside there by Fedorov, and a perfect pass over to Krivchenko, who rips that one past Halo. You'll see it there. No chance for the Slovakian goaltender at all. Great shot there by Igor Krivchenko. Russia keeps up the pressure. Initial shot there taken by Bolshikov. We get a good replay of the deflection by Gimatov. Great little stick there, and that one tips past Hollow. Again, no chance. He was screened pretty cleanly in front. So after one period of play, 3-0, the Russians up on Slovakia. In the second, Barbashev bursts in with a great chance, but he'll slide it right under Hollow. You see there, just outside the post. Next, there's a turnover, and Peter Gapa with the chance, but easily handled by Belov. Next up, the Russians, 2-on-2. Leshin fires that one, but it deflects off of the stick of Palovich and up and over the glass, out of play. Oleg Lee here with a quick stop. That one right into the glove of Hollow as Russia keeps up the pressure. And here you'll see Soloviev, as he's able to walk right into the slot, backhand that one off the crossbar and out. Slovakian fans still trying to keep up hope as we move into the third period. Here is Maslov, able to walk right in, but a great left pad save there by Halo. Now Torcheniak drives to the net, and that one swept through the crease, but cleared by Slovakia. And then Soloviev with a couple chances here on the power play. Here's the first one, and then the rebound comes, but is stopped by Halo. Slovakia having a quick conversation with the official. Russia still in the power play. A nice little slap pass there, and Fedorov banks at home, but it's going to be ruled no goal, as they're saying that it was kicked in, but it doesn't appear to be. It does go off his skate, but does not appear to be kicked in. Nonetheless, no goal. Krivchenko then with a great snapshot up and over the shoulder of Halo. He plays for Ryazan in Russia's VHL. Great look at it there. Halo maybe down a bit early, but that's a great shot by Krivchenko for his second of the afternoon. Now here's a great pass from Lebedev to set up Gimatov for his hat trick in fifth of the tournament. An easy tap in there for the Russian winger. Russian fans quite liking the way this one's rolling out. 5-0, Russia on the power play. And there's a one-timer from Soloviev. Hollow screened, had no chance, didn't even see it until it was by him. Now 6-0 for the Russians. Russia again on the power play with under 3 minutes to go. And this one will actually deflect in off of the defenseman Gapa. Get a good look at it here coming up in a second. The shot kind of rifles in and then banks off both the Russian player and Gapa. 7-0. That is how it'll end. Shots 47-23 in favor of the Russians. They will now move on to the semifinal, where they will take on the winner of the Canada-US matchup in quarterfinal play.
Education meets sport and culture. What best promotes excellence in mind and body? Where do friendship, integrity, and achievement meet? Which event gathers the best student athletes from around the world? The Universiade, the home of international university sports. Today's stars, tomorrow's leaders.